We are live. Good morning, Alfred Street Baptist Church.
Good morning.
To our virtual online family and friends. I am so happy and glad that you joined us this morning. And since we are already friends, I'm going to just go ahead and share. You know, I like lists. I like listing things. So I'm going to list for you guys the top three reasons why I am so overjoyed and I am so happy that I am here hosting the Prelude on this Sunday morning. All right, so coming in at number three, I am just so happy that I get to be in this sanctuary at the historic Alfred Street Baptist Church. If you look into the sanctuary, it is already full of so many people. Let me tell you, they will come here and stand in line if it's snowing, if it's raining, if it's hot, if it's cold. They don't care. They get here by, what, trains, planes, automobiles. They make a way to get here on the corner of South Alfred Street and Duke Street. The number two reason, Mel, why I am so happy that I get to be with our virtual friends and family online is that I get to be with them. I'm engaging with you guys. I'm looking to see who is here in the chat because you guys are shouting yourselves out and where you are from. I love that. And so drum roll, the number one reason why I am so excited, I am so hyped, I am so overjoyed is because I get to co-host with who? My bestie, Melissa Crokey.
Too kind. I love that.
Thank you.
In keeping with the list, let me do my list. Instead of three, let's do four.
Okay, she's an overachiever. I see she's always trying to show me up.
And
it's
number
okay.
One, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Like you, I'm happy to be here at These Alfred Streets. Number two, it's the first month of a new season. Can we say fresh anointing anyone?
Yes.
Number three, this is my second time being a co-host of the Prelude.
Yes.
I think I've worked through the kinks of the nerves. Excited to be here again. And of course, I will never miss an opportunity to be with the sidekick, the bestie, the Tiffany Dix.
Oh, okay. It's kind of like Oprah and Gail.
Or Thelma and Louise.
Frickin' Frat.
You decide who's Frick.
You decide who's Frat.
You decide who's Oprah.
You decide who's Gail.
Thelma.
And Louise.
Amen and amen.
Amen and amen. So, like I said, you guys, I want to know who you are. I want to know where you are. Please drop your name, drop your location in the chat.
And we are
going to say hello, and we're going to shout you out this morning on the Prelude.
Yeah. So how was your week?
You know, my week was really good. Recouping from Holy Week and Easter was like a lot here in these Alfred Streets, but I'm my spirits are up. How about you?
You know, my week was really good. And yesterday I started something new. Have you all heard of Kaya Moves? 75 days of activity launched yesterday.
It did.
I'm a little concerned.
So, you know, Reverend Ty Jones called me yesterday morning. And when I saw his name come across the caller ID, I was like, my brother is about to pray with his sister in Christ. I was like, what a glorious way to start the day. But that's not what he was calling for.
What was he calling for?
He was making sure that I was already starting my exercise for the Kaya movement. And he stressing me out already, and it's only been a day.
Listen, that's timely. Do you all know that April is the National Stress Awareness Month? And also timely, one of the key ways that you can eliminate or reduce stress is by moving, getting active. Physical activity of any sort helps to relieve and reduce stress.
You know what? I'm really happy that you told me that because I have to work with Reverend Ty, and I know he's going to be a complete drill sergeant when it comes to this Kaya move. So I probably have to do the hard and not the easy that I thought I was going to do because I need all the stress relief from Ty. Don't tell him I said that.
Listen.
That I could get. So I'm about to be out here exercising. So if y'all see me in these Alfred Streets, it's because Ty, I don't want him getting on my nerves.
Well, boost those feel-good endorphins. I'm going to stick with the soft. I'm going to stick with the easy. But I am going to join in with the Kaya Moves for that 75-day challenge. I think it goes until June 20th.
Yes, it does. So I see that our online friends and family are already active and hype in the chat, so we're going to start shouting some out. I want to say hello to Tamara from Oakland, California.
Oakland in the house. Welcome to worship.
Somebody said good morning from Louisiana. Now, I had some good food when we went to Louisiana a couple years ago. So amen and praise the Lord. We're going to have to come visit.
And we appreciate your ministry. Welcome to worship. worship.
We have Miss Dorothy Dodson from Butler, Pennsylvania's in the house.
Welcome to worship. Is that Deacon May in the NPR, sir?
Okay, Deacon May.
Welcome to worship.
Deacon May is giving us a shout out. We love you, Deacon May.
Welcome to worship.
That's one of our favorite deacons here at Alfred Street Baptist Church.
Amen and amen.
But don't tell the other deacons we said you're our favorite, because we don't want no smoke in these Alfred Streets.
Do not.
We also have, let's see here, we have Beverly. She is in Gaithersburg, Maryland.
Good morning, Sister Beverly. Welcome to worship.
And somebody gave us a shout out. Somebody said, I love this show. Go Tiffany and Mel.
KS, welcome to worship.
Welcome to worship. All right, so one of the things my best friend always says is that I never meet a stranger. Everywhere we go, I'm always chit-chatting it up and end up making friends. And nothing is different when I'm in these Alfred Streets. So here's one of my friends, and he happens to work here. And so he's going to introduce himself to you guys at home.
What's up, everybody? I'm Reverend Byron Jones. I serve as worship coordinator and volunteer engagement here at the amazing Alfred Street Baptist Church.
The amazing Alfred Street. Somebody's trying to keep their job. No, it is amazing.
Pastor, try my hardest.
Well, look, we were just talking about stress and talking about how exercise is a great stress reliever and mood lifter. What are some of the things that you do to stay active and to decompress?
So for me, I love reading a good book. I love walking in nature, working out, and trying my best to be around community, friends who I think better me and just bring me peace.
Amen.
I love that.
Are you going to do the Kaya moves?
You know, I am. I am. And specifically, I'm going to do the 75 hard.
Okay, y'all heard it here. He said he's doing the 75 hard.
That's a
and
challenge.
And I already told y'all that I was going to do it because I don't want Reverend Dr. Todd Drill Sergeant getting on my case every day. So we about to be in these Alpha Streets working out.
Well, y'all check on your hard friends. I'm going to be living that soft life. Soft life.
Soft life. Okay, I don't blame your friend. Thank you, Byron. Thank you. This is a work day for Byron, so I got to let him go so he can get back to his day job. Thank you, Byron.
Thanks for being with us.
All right. So don't forget, continue dropping your name, shouting your own self out, and just whatever you want to say, lifting somebody up in prayer in these comments, because we want to hear from you guys at home.
Yeah.
All right. So last week you mentioned it was last week we were at the Strathmore in Bethesda, Maryland, celebrating Resurrection Sunday. It was absolutely beautiful, Mel.
It was phenomenal. It was great to be in the building, great to fellowship, great to worship, an amazing experience.
And I'm going to pause right there. Tyra, because I actually am the producer of the Prelude, so I'm working double duty today. So I'm just letting my homegirl Tyra in the booth know that she needs to cue that video, because I'm here replacing my homeboy, Minister Otis Bird. I miss you. I love you. I can't wait to see you, homie, when you get back on Tuesday.
I love you, Minister Bird.
Keep going.
Yeah, Easter was amazing. And so I know that there were some who wanted to be in the physical space at the Strathmore. Want to let you know that per Pastor Wesley's prayer earlier this week, we are looking into getting a larger venue for Easter 2025. And so the plans are already underway. We are excited about what's coming.
Maybe we'll have our own stadium tour. Like, do you think we can get FedEx Field, maybe?
Put your hands up.
I receive. All right, so at this moment, we want you guys to reflect on what we went through last Sunday at the Strathmore, celebrating our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Please go ahead and cue that video.
I was down, but now I'm up. Yeah. This all God, this ain't no luck. Yeah. I used to be stuck in that mud. Whoa. Yeah, I was down, but now I'm up. I was down, but now I'm up. Yeah. This all God, this ain't no love. Yeah. I used to be stuck in that mud. Yeah. Yeah. I was down, but now I'm up. Hey. I was down, but now I'm up. Like my name Lazarus. No Satan gon' be mad at this. I had to ask my dad if it's okay to swing my bat at this. He said, boy, if I picture this out of the park, moving so quick, it's like they stuck in park. They see the numbers, but I see the heart. 10,000 hours you spit in the dark, putting in good work.
Yes, that was just last Sunday at the Strathmore Easter at Alfred Street 2024. And like we said, we cannot wait for Easter 2025. And so we are back in this chat box right here. And Can I just say something, Mel?
Say it.
My family is watching from Sewell, New Jersey. Hi, Grandma, my aunt, my dad, my Uncle
Grandma,
Cedric, my Aunt Kim.
Hey, Auntie, Uncles. Hi,
love
Mr. Smith.
Thanks for the support. We also have, let me see here, we have Eddie from the STL. Look, I'm from Missouri, so I always got to shout out somebody from the Show Me State. So
Amen.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship.
We have Teresa. She is up the road in Silver Spring morning. Good morning.
Silver Spring, welcome to worship.
We have Justin Williams from Virginia and Kathy from Seattle. Good morning.
Good morning.
She
welcome
got that
to
good
worship.
Coffee in Seattle.
Listen.
They got one of those Starbucks.
And do.
That Starbucks Reserve.
And do.
Yo, we got go to Starbucks Reserve. You heard it from Tiffany and Mel. It's all the things. All right. So what's going up? Who do we have in for worship today?
You know what? I think we're preparing for the incredible Reverend Dr. Robert Ty Jones. And if it was anything like the 8 a.m. worship service, we are in for an amazing treat and an amazing time of worship, praise. It's going to be a beautiful worship experience.
So let me ask you, do you think that Reverend Ty is going to sing today?
Hands down. Without hesitation.
You heard it here first. We think he's going to sing from the pulpit.
Get ready.
And let me tell y'all something, but you can't tell anybody. Reverend Ty and I, we go back and forth. He's from Memphis. I'm from Kansas City about who has the best barbecue. Hands down, Kansas City. You heard it here first on the Prelude. So if you see Reverend Ty out here in these Alfred streets, say, yeah, Tiffany is right. Kansas City has the best barbecue. But no, I love Reverend Dr. Ty Jones. He's an amazing preacher, and I'm really excited to see him bring the word this morning.
I'm excited as well. And I also want to do one more shout out. Danki from Kenya, welcome to worship. Thank you for being with us. We are preparing now for praise and worship with royal priesthood under the direction of the Theodore the Third. We are excited about being in worship with you all. Thank you for joining us for the Prelude in.
And we are so happy that Pastor Wesley let this dynamic duo host the Prelude this morning.
Amen.
We love you guys. Have a blessed, beautiful
Welcome
Sunday.
Welcome to worship.
Bye.
Anybody know God is here? Who came to worship this morning? We serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. Would you look at your neighbor and just say, I'm good to see you this morning. And we come to worship God in spirit and in truth. It's a simple song that says, oh Lord, we worship and adore your holy name. Let's all sing together. Oh Lord,
oh Lord,
we worship and adore your holy name. Anybody came to worship this morning? Everybody sing. Oh Lord,
we worship.
Come on, you just lift your hands and worship and adore.
Your name.
Can we go up? Oh Lord,
we worship
and adore
your name.
Is that all right? Everybody sing.
Yeah.
the joy and the strength.
God is the joy and the strength of my life.
He moves
all pain.
Come on. He promised to keep me.
Never to leave.
He's never, ever, ever. I've got to fast and pray.
Stay in the name.
Come on. Keep my life clean.
Every day.
I want to go with him.
I want to go with him when he comes.
I've come too far. Can we say that again, everybody? God is the joy and the strength of my life. He moves all pain. Come on. He promised to keep you and me.
Never to leave
me. He's never, ever, ever come. I've got to fast and pray.
Stay in the narrow way.
And keep my life clean.
Oh,
I want to go
with.
Let's stay right there. I want to go with him. Anybody want to go with him?
I want to go with him.
Song says, I've come too far.
And I'll never
say, God is. Worship him on this morning. Now put those hands together, because we serve a mighty good God. Come on, everybody, come on.
Oh, yes. serve a risen Savior in this world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. You ask me how I know he lives.
He lives within my heart. Oh yes, he lives within my heart.
I serve a risen Savior in this world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. You ask me how I know he lives. Hey, Jesus. Christ Jesus. He walked with me and he talked with me along the narrow way. He lives. Salvation.
to your name, God. Somebody missed their cue. Mighty good God. Oh, somebody missed their cue. Mighty good God. Hallelujah. Yes. Ha! Mighty good God. Glory to your name, God. Serve a risen Savior. He's all the world to me, and He is a mighty good God. I didn't need a little teeny God that couldn't do the heavy work. I needed a mighty good God to show up in my life, because I got mighty big stuff going on, and mighty big prayers that I'm praying, and mighty big expectations, and I need a mighty big God. Lord, help. That's why Marcus got to play so hard that the headphones fall down on his face. Because while y'all standing and rocking and shouting, he got to work that thing out over there on that organ, and he got to know that he knows that he knows that he's playing and talking to a mighty big God. Somebody need a mighty big God. Glory to the name, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. Bless the name, God. Woo. Church, so I can praise my mighty big God in the midst of my mighty big life and know that He is here and listening and working it out for my good. Good morning, Alfred Street. Get in where you fit in, because the Spirit of the Lord is moving in this place. And everything that you need, every answer you've been waiting for, can be yours if you get in where you fit in. This is not the moment to be shy. Don't hold back your praise. Let your tears release you and lift you up. Because I was glad when they said unto me, there's a place of refuge. So let us go into the house of the Lord. So as soon as my feet struck Zion, I began to clap my hands. I began to lift my voice. I began to open my mouth, and I began to raise a praise to the Almighty God. Alfred Street virtual family, overflow room, every space, every place, we welcome you. And so we transition so that we can now stand in the gap for someone else. hold that space, and now lift up someone else. So church, this morning we're praying for Sister Jacqueline Jones as her mother has passed, Sister Katie L. Hall. We're praying for Sister Jacqueline and Misty Sims in the passing of their husband, father, Merrill Sims. Daryl and Vanita Chever are on our list this morning. It's the mother and mother-in-law, Margaret Chever. It's transitioned to be with the Lord. Our sister, Cynthia Watson, we're praying for her in the passing of her uncle, John Jerry Burbridge. We're praying for Sister Deborah Crawford in the passing of her niece, Kendra Page. And we are lifting up Reverend Otis Byrd in the passing of his grandmother, Mrs. Mary Elaine Byrd. Who are you praying for, church? Thank you, God, for hearing whispers of prayer. And so we stand waiting, oh God, for answers of love. And Father, as we lift up these that are mourning in this moment, carry them, keep them, dry their tears, and let them know that what they feel is the presence of you, because we have invoked your spirit by prayer. God, someone is praying for themselves right now because life is just a little too difficult and challenging and overwhelming, and they're having a hard time finding a way to just breathe. So thank you for the prescription that you gave on this morning to help move us in a way to relinquish some of what we're carrying. Someone is praying for a family member. Somebody is praying because there's someone sick, someone homeless, someone hungry, someone in need, oh God. And so if we can't meet the need, we pray right now, God, that you make a way for the need to be met. And where we can be your hands and your feet and your voice, God, give us provision and compassion to do so. We thank you for this privilege and opportunity of prayer, because we know as a result you will answer. So God, in this moment, we lift up the preacher. We thank you for the word. We lift up our pastor, and we ask that you continue to keep and cover him. We lift up those that are missing from this circle today and ask, oh God, that you do only what you can do, and that is be a mighty God. It's your servant's prayer. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. We're going to now have our morning scripture. Let's lift up the morning scripture, and then we will move right into royal priesthood leading us in our morning hymn. Amen. Familiar passage of scripture. We've already tried it. We found it to be true. Amen. Amen. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. I hear you. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy and everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. That is the mighty God that we serve. Let us sing together with royal priesthood. He lives.
The song says, you ask me how, I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Let's lift up this hymn together. The first verse, I serve I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living. Whatever men may say, I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. At just the time I need Him, He's always there. Everybody says He lives. Christ Jesus lives. He walks with me and talks with me. Salvation to impart. You ask me how. He lives within my heart. Second stanza says, in all the world, I see His loving care. And though my heart, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of His appearing will come at last. Everybody sings, He lives. Christ Jesus lives. He walks with me and talks with me. Salvation. You ask me how. He lives within my heart. Let's go to that last answer. Rejoice. Lift up your voice. Eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ our King. The hope of all, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good, and kind. Everybody sings, He lives. Christ Jesus lives. For He walks with me and talks with me. He lives. Salvation. You ask me how. He lives.
Church, we're going to take that as a testimony and a cue for us to now pass the peace to one another.
There's a sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on His face, and I know that it's the presence of the Lord.
Sweet Holy Spirit.
We hope that you received your communion as you came in. If not, just lift your hands and a deacon will serve you to make sure that you have it. We have a few hands in the back. We have a few hands at the top. Couple hands at the top. Hang on, they're on the way. That's right. In the meantime, you can shake, shake, shake. Start trying to get those little films open. Amen. I believe everyone has been served. There's some song lyrics that come to mind. I shared this morning. I looked them up this time because I got brain fog. So y'all pray for a sister. But they help us remember and reflect in this moment. You gave that I might live. You gave that I might be set free. You exchanged your life for mine. What a marvelous thing you've done. And we say that it's marvelous, but that marvelous work was not without sacrifice and cost. And to some, it may seem free, but it cost our Savior his life. But a life he was willing to lay down so that we could experience eternal life and freedom and relationship with him. And for that, I am grateful. We're reminded that as often as we do this, as often as we drink, eat the bread and drink the cup, that we hold space to remember our Christ, that sacrifice and his return. So together, family, let us take the bread in remembrance of his body, broken, bruised for our iniquities, and let us share together. And likewise with the cup, symbolic of his blood that never loses its power, but shed nonetheless, let us drink together. Thank you for gathering us together. Thank you, God, for ending the scatteredness of our lives and connecting us with family and community and congregation that we can come to the table and share. Thank you for your sacrifice. Amen. So now we would like to take a moment and acknowledge our guests. Do we have any first-time visitors with us today? Just lift your hands. Amen. 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 Welcome to Alfred Street and welcome to the sanctuary. Amen. 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 We're glad that you are here and that you chose to worship with us on today. Any anniversaries today? Any couples celebrating any anniversary today? Ask that you stand. Oh, they popped up. Amen. There's two. Three. Four. All right. Starting at the top, all the way at the top. Good morning. Yes, you. Good morning. Could you share with us how many years you're celebrating? 19 years. All right. Will you share with us? 16. Amen. Amen. Here? 30. Amen. Last but certainly not least, 33. Woo! All right. So we've got the teenagers and the 30s in the house today. They'll both be in the lobby for advice. Amen. Congratulations on your anniversary. May God bless you with many, many more. And last but not least, are there any birthdays in the house this morning? Yay! All right, another year. Thank God. Thank God for another year. May this year be the best one yet. And let us know when you get what you wished for, all right? It's because you were here today. Enjoy your birthday season. Just a couple of announcements this morning. This first one, though, is the most important of them all. Pastor Wesley says, good morning, Alfred Street. And he sends his love to each and every one of you. He will be back soon. Amen. We would like to let you know about the junior youth. So they have Fellowship Fridays happening for junior youth. They are held every second Friday of the month. And so the next outing is scheduled for this coming Friday, April the 10th, from 7 to 9. So they want you to go to the website so that you can get the details and register there, okay? And then, as a church family, we will get ready to do baptism, right hand of fellowship, and communion together in the sanctuary next Saturday, April the 13th. So we ask that you come, tune in, and let us welcome the newest members of Alfred Street. Amen? Amen. Did I forget anything? Any other announcements? All right, we're ready to go. We have an amazing, not a guest anymore, he's ours. We have an amazing preacher in the house this morning in the person of Reverend Dr. Robert Ty Jones. And we are waiting and excited to hear what God is instructing through his voice on this morning. And so after we have, the amazing royal priesthood come and bless us with the sermonic selection under the direction of Theodore Thorpe, the very next voice you will hear will be that of Reverend Dr. Ty Jones. Alfred Street, there are a number of ways that you can give because as you can see, we don't take a traditional offering. We're not passing a plate. Amen. Our pastor teaches us that mature Christians know what they should do. Amen? And there are many ways that you can do that. You can go to the website and hit give, or you can use one of the options that are on the screen. But we ask that you do your part. Give back to God what you believe. That's your relationship between you and God, what you believe God has shared with you to sow into this good work. Amen? Amen. So let us pray, and then we will be blessed with the selection. God, thank you in this moment for provision. That right there is enough. Thank you, God, for providing and ensuring that we are taken care of, because that's what a good father does. And so help us, oh God, as we mature in this space of giving back to you, that you will bless it, that it will be used accordingly for the needs and the upbuilding of the kingdom. We thank you, we praise you, and honor you. And we even pray, God, for those that might still be struggling or not even have anything to give. So allow their service, oh God, unto you. Let it be blessed and let it be prosperous so that no one feels left out. We're all in this thing together, and we will do what you have called us to do with that. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Prepare yourselves for an amazing selection and the Word of God.
Wipe your eyes. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. I'll try it one more time. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Give me some. I got one more in me and I gotta go, but oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt his name together. Anybody got a reason to lift him up today? Anybody got reason to say hallelujah today? Anybody got a reason to say thank you, Jesus, today? Lift up the name of Jesus. Yeah. Lord, we thank you that you are an awesome God. Lord, there's so many things that we could thank you for. But Lord, if there's one thing, if we ain't got nothing else to thank you for, we can thank you that the tomb is empty. And because the tomb is empty, it's legitimate for us to ask, why do you cry? We can lift up our heads because you got up from the grave. We thank you. But now, Lord, it is preaching time. I know that I can't do this without you, only through you. Praying you would saturate my spirit and allow your word to go forth in a mighty way where your people will be helped. And we'll be sure to give you all praise, glory, and honor. It is your darling son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Do me a favor, look to somebody to the left or the right and say, I'm so happy to be sitting next to you. Yeah. Now raise your hand if you told a lie in church. Raise your... To our pastor, the Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley and his family. Come on, give God praise for him. I want to thank him publicly for allowing me to come and to stand where he stands every Sunday and proclaims the word of God. People don't have to be kind, and when they're kind, they don't have to be kind to you. And I'm thankful just to be here today. I had a friend, one of my best friends in the whole wide world. I talked to him this week and told me his father passed unexpectedly. And I came to church this morning in a different type of way. Where I'm from, there's an old country song we would sing that said, we thank you for one more sunny day. And I'm just happy for one more sunny day. I don't want to hold y'all too long. I know brunch is on your mind. Let's go to a familiar passage of scripture, John chapter 21. I love you, Jesus. I worship and just want that I love
you more than
any. I just want that I love you more. Come on, lift it up. We headed to the word. I love. I worship that I love more than anything. One more time. No music, just y'all. I want to hear.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and that's why I praise you, I lift you up, and I magnify. Yeah. Come on, I know you know it. I know it's old school, but y'all mind going back? That's why. Yeah. Come on, sing it like you mean it. I love you. It's simple. I love you. Yeah.
I love you, Lord.
Why? Because. In such a special way. That's why. I lift you up. And I magnify your name. That's why. When I was down to my last dime, you stepped in right on time. That's why. When I was left alone, Jesus, you brought me along. That's why. Yeah. Last time. Oh, that's why. That's why. John chapter 21, I'll be coming from the Christian Standard Bible. When you find it, say amen. Reason this wise, I want to do a little reading here. After this, Jesus revealed himself again to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. He revealed himself in this way: Simon Peter, Thomas called Twin, Nathanael from Cana of Galilee, Zebedee's sons, and two others of his disciples were together. I'm going fishing, Simon Peter said to them. We're coming with you, they told him. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing, chowed nothing. And when daybreak came, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not know it was Jesus. Friends, Jesus called to them, you don't have any fish, do you? No, they answered. Cast the net on the right side of the boat, he told them, and you'll find some. So they did. They were unable to haul it in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple, the one Jesus loved, said to Peter, it is the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he tied his outer clothing around him, for he had taken it off and plunged into the sea. Since they were not far from land, about 100 yards away, the other disciples came in the boat dragging the net full of fish. And when they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish lying on it and bread. Bring some of the fish you've just caught. And Jesus told them, so Simon Peter climbed up and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And even though there were so many, the net was not torn. Come and have breakfast, Jesus told them. None of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus then took bread and gave it to them. He did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. Y'all don't mind, for a brief amount of time, I want to tag this text, what that got to do with me? What that got to do with me? You may be see that. What? What that got to do with me? Yeah. One of the more beloved films in the history of America is The Wizard of Oz. There's an interesting conversation that occurs between Dorothy and Scarecrow. It goes something like this. Dorothy says, are you doing that on purpose or can't you make up your mind? Scarecrow says, that's the trouble. I can't make up my mind. I haven't got a brain, just straw. Dorothy then asks, how can you talk if you haven't got a brain? Scarecrow said, I don't know, but some people without brains do an awful lot of talking, don't they? Isn't that the truth? That Scarecrow is truly on to something, because people without brains seem to do an awful amount of talking. But when we lead into this conversation a bit closer, something jumps out at us, doesn't it? Because how can one with no brain even formulate sentences without the presence of the mind? And logically, one with no brain can't make a profound statement without having one. It doesn't make sense. As a matter of fact, it's called a non sequitur. The words non sequitur are Latin words that mean does not follow. That a non sequitur is when is a statement where the conclusion just does not logically follow given the premise. As a matter of fact, have you ever been talking to someone and you made a statement and their response had nothing to do with what you just said? Growing up in my household, it happened all the time because my mother was in the house with three boys and her husband, and oftentimes we liked to watch basketball or watch something on TV, and she would bust in on our party and had to always give us some information that we didn't know what she was talking about. Potentially, oh, that furniture just went on sale. And then typically we would respond with something that had nothing to do with the furniture. And Mama, in her own way, would always say things like, what does that have to do with the price of tea in China? It's a non sequitur, that when the statement has nothing to do with what was previously stated. So it seemingly makes no sense at all. Non sequiturs are in our daily lives, our jobs, and our relationships, that people are always making statements that have nothing to do with what preceded it. And I find it fitting that as we come to the first Sunday after Good Resurrection Sunday, I was having a conversation with a young man recently, and we were talking about the events that surround the Holy Week. He said, yeah, y'all went to all those services last week. I mean, we were in church on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, y'all skipped Saturday. We got here early on Sunday, then drove to the Strathmore at 11 o'clock. I mean, we were in church all week long. This young man was asking me about what it means to have this and celebrate Holy Week, and I did the best explanation I could give to him. But after we finished talking, he said, yeah, I understand that Jesus got up, but what that got to do with me? He said, yeah, I understand that he got up on Good Sunday morning with all power in his hands, but what that got to do with me? I don't want to correct his English. I appreciate the way he said it, and it's very real, raw, and authentic. He said, I know Jesus got up, but what that got to do with me? And I know that's offensive to some of you all that are listening to me now, because that messes up your Baptist in you, because we know that we came all week long to sit in church to hear the preacher tell the story that one Friday they marched him from judgment hall to judgment hall. They put a crown of thorns on his head, pierced him in the side, put nails in his feet. He went in the grave on Friday, stayed there all Friday night, stayed there all Saturday, stayed there all Saturday night. But early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. And that's all good and all, but this young man had a question. He said, what that got to do with me? You know, I think that that's actually an important question that you and I wrestle with sometimes, because if you take your holy halo off, and you place it down so that your neighbor doesn't know the real you. You be honest that there are times in your life that when you know things about God, that doesn't match the way you feel about God. That, yeah, Lord, I know you're a healer, but what that got to do with me? I know you can make a way, but what that got to do with me? I know you brought film out, but what that got to do with me? You see, oftentimes in our personal experiences, we are searching for the relevancy of the God that we serve. In other words, all of us can attest to the fact at some point in time in our lives, asking the very pressing question that this young man asked, what does that have to do with me? And I think we find ourselves in a very interesting position when we come to John chapter 21. These disciples find themselves after crucifixion. Jesus has been crucified, buried, and resurrected from the grave. However, what are the implications for them? Yeah, Jesus got up, but what does that mean for them? Yeah, he got up from the grave, but what does that mean for them? I want to answer this question today, and I promise y'all I'm done, and I'll leave y'all be. But I just want to suggest that clarity about who Jesus is brings about hope that is manifested in a few ways. It's manifested in a way that we can reimagine our failures, that then gives us advice for full circle moments, that then gives us revelation, that then fosters audacity. I'll give it to you one more time. You may be taking notes. That clarity about who Jesus is, it brings about a hope that manifests itself in a reimagination of our failures, that then allows for full circle moments, that can then give revelation, that fosters audacity. What does the resurrection of Jesus Christ have to do with you? It's very simple. There's always tomorrow. There's always a plan, and there's always more. That's my sermon in a sentence. What does Jesus have to do with you getting up on Sunday morning? All I came today was to tell you that there's always tomorrow. There's always a plan, and there's always more. Y'all didn't move, so I'm going to say it one more time. What does the resurrection communicate? That there's always tomorrow, there's always a plan, and there's always more. As a matter of fact, I noticed what I said, that it brings about hope. Let the church shout hope. That word hope in the Greek is an interesting word because it lends itself to concrete expectation. It means I expect concretely what's about to happen. And I know many of us have there's a difference between wishing for something and hoping for something. Wishing for something doesn't have a foundation, but hoping for something always does. As a matter of fact, it reminds me of that old mother that went to that preacher after a three-night revival. The first night he preached, she went to him. She said, "Preacher, you hoped me on tonight." He said, "Yeah." He said, "Thank you, mother. I don't really know what that means, but God bless you. I'll see you tomorrow night." Second night came, he preached his heart out, and mother came to him afterwards and said, "Preacher, you hoped me on tonight." He said, "Thank you, mother, again. I really appreciate it. Figure something might be wrong with mama." But then the third night comes back again and preaches his heart out. And mother came back to him and said the very same thing. That "Preacher, you hoped me on tonight." And then on that night, it was the last night, the preacher said, "Mother, I got a question for you. Because the past 3 days, you've been telling me I hoped you tonight." She said, "But don't you mean help you?" Mother said, "No, baby, I don't mean help. I meant hope." He said, "Well, mother, what is the difference between helping you and hoping you?" She looked that preacher in the face and gave the best sermon that he had ever heard. She said, "Hope is what you hold on to until help shows up in your life." I don't know who I'm talking to today, but in the midst of your struggle, I'm trying to give you something to hold on to. That because Jesus got up, you and I always got hope in our life. Let me hurry. That's where we see. And this very familiar passage of scripture, John paints this particular narrative at an interesting point.
That John is different than the other writers, other gospel writers, isn't he? That you remember the Gospel of Matthew begins in interesting fashion. Begins with the genealogy of Christ, showing us how Christ came from 42 generations. Showing how this is not just something, but God has had a plan all the time. The Gospel of Mark begins rather abruptly. It begins the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we are ushered into a story that seems to be almost in continuation. And then there's Luke. Luke begins with his address at Theophilus, saying that ultimately I have compiled all of this data, almost like a historian, to present this message unto you. But then there's old John. John begins in John chapter 1 saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I'd have you to know that John just doesn't begin differently than the other Gospels. He also ends differently than the other Gospels, because this particular narrative that we are in today isn't found in any of the other Gospels. If you don't mind, come with me to the Sea of Tiberias, or rather the Sea of Galilee, as you probably know it to be. The disciples have now come out of hiding because Jesus has gotten up from the grave. And sure, it's a typical day. They've been there before. I mean, they know this land pretty well. They know the terrain. They know the sea. They know how things go. They look at the temperature and they decide that we are going to go back fishing. But notice how the text reads. It says, after this, Jesus revealed himself. And then the second verse says, and he revealed himself in this way. That word in the Greek, reveal, it lends itself to shining, or rather to bring into clarity. That before we even begin this passage, we are aware of the nature of it. It's to shine, or to bring clarity to the disciples about who Jesus really is. And Peter has made a decision. Peter said, after all of this, I'm going fishing. And then the others, Thomas, Nathaniel, James, and John, and two other unnamed disciples, Jesus reveals himself to these men. But don't you find this particularly interesting? Because you see, every year around this time, the disciples come under a lot of scrutiny. They are stained by two different scriptures. They are stained by Mark chapter 14, verse 50, and Matthew chapter 26, verse 56, that says, then all the disciples deserted him and ran away. That while Jesus is being crucified, the disciples, they run away. While Jesus is being lynched, the disciples, the male disciples, they run away. But I got a question, AlfredstreetBC. Why did they run? Why did they run? It's interesting that we always talk about the reality that they ran, but nobody ever asked why. Why is it that they run? You see, there's very little evidence for the common practice of the crucifixion of women. It's very little evidence that we see supported. And to add to the point, it generally is believed that these young men, that while serving as apprentices of Jesus Christ, are quite possibly teenagers. That means that if the oldest boy was 18 at the time of our text, he only would have been 21 years old. They were young men in fear for their lives, and they ran. You see, do you and I do to the disciples what we typically do to black men on the regular? When desiring to provide an explanation for some of their behavior, we reach for the lowest hanging fruit. And you and I must be careful in our reaching for the lowest hanging fruit and the most accessible rationale, because sometimes it can have dangerous implications. Because when we reach for the lowest hanging fruit, little boys get characterized as bad by the education system and placed into special education classes and get put on medicine, which then funds pharmaceutical companies. When we reach for low-hanging fruit, Baltimore will build a billion-dollar jail that will be the most expensive state-funded project in history. When we reach for low-hanging fruit, teenage boys always struggle to see a picture of a man because there are financial incentives for the father not to be there. Some of us can be upset at them for running, but all of us need to be careful to criticize circumstances that we don't even share. In other words, you be careful about running your mouth about people whose shoes you've never walked in. Ain't that the problem most of the time in church? You always got something somebody saying something about what you went through and saying something about what you having to go through. But if they ever had to live 24 hours in your shoes, they'd be in somewhere in the hospital. Be careful how you criticize people. But hold on. This failure is not simply limited to their reputation. Look at it here. The text says that when daybreak came, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples did not know it was Jesus. And Jesus raised the question. Let me tell y'all something. Sometimes if it had been me, Jesus would have made me upset. I've been out here fishing all night long. And you come out of nowhere asking me, do you have any fish? No, man, what you mean? Now, Jesus says, do you have any fish? And I know, because some of you are upset that they are even fishing in the first place. Because you believe that they should have been out there saving souls for the kingdom, and I get it. But there's no evidence to suggest that they were doing, that what they were doing was wrong. As a matter of fact, disciples have to eat. Hey, disciples have to eat. I know y'all holy. I know you're spiritual. But you got to eat. You got bills to pay. You got to go to work. You got to do, these are mundane, routine things. And so they have to eat. But there are nothing is not necessarily a punishment. It's just a failure. However, what if I told you that failure doesn't always have to be failure? Because I believe the gospel showcases that sometimes failure is just the beginning of what God is about to do. As a matter of fact, Raymond Brown notes here, he says that nothing is always the backdrop for God to work a miracle. If you look throughout the entire gospel, you will always find the disciples, they never catch fish unless Jesus is there. And maybe there's somebody here today, you feel as if nothing is your lot, that's the hand that you have been dealt. And Jesus appears to these individuals in key fashion, I believe, for this reason, because he had told them earlier that apart from me, you can do nothing. And they are living, breathing examples of such that why would Jesus appear to such failures? And some of you remember that song, remember that movie? It was way before my time, 1977. It was this little redhead girl by the name of Annie. She was an orphan that grew up in an orphanage that was being mistreated. And Annie had a song that she would sing, didn't she? She said, the sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that there'll be sun. Annie would go on singing that refrain, tomorrow, tomorrow, I'll love you tomorrow. You're only a day away. Now, Annie came out in 1977. And we thank God for Annie. Thank God for her ministry and how she's blessed people all over the world. But that ain't my Annie. As a matter of fact, there's some Gen Z and millennials in here today that we have our own version of Annie. But listen, our Annie isn't white and our Annie doesn't have red hair. But she looks and talks a little different. She was born in Memphis, Tennessee. As a matter of fact, her name is Gloria Hallelujah Woods. She goes by the stage name of Glorilla. And as a matter of fact, Glorilla is new to the music scene, but she had a song that took off a while ago called Tomorrow. Now let me pause here. I'm not telling any of y'all to go look up the lyrics. I will not be responsible if you go and listen to what Glorilla had to say. But the last song, the last line of the song by Glorilla says, every day the sun won't shine, but that's why I love tomorrow. And while she was preparing for a new album to come out, some of y'all remember about 2 weeks ago when she was on CNN and Glorilla gave me this, and I said, I can't wait to tell Alfred Street this. She said, at the end of the day gotta end. And that's all I came to tell somebody here today. If you're going through failure in your life, it's got to end. If you're going through struggle in your life, at the end of the day got to end. Grieving right now, at the end of the day got to end. Why don't you touch your neighbor beside you and say, it's got an expiration day on it. And trouble don't last always. Look at somebody and say, it's got to end. It's got, I know it hurts right now, but it's got to end. I know it's painful right now, but it's got to end. As a matter of fact, can we take time, take about 10 seconds and give God the best praise? Because we know that what I'm going through, it's got to end sometime. I'm moving. It guarantees that a resurrected Jesus guarantees that there's always a tomorrow. A resurrected Jesus guarantees that there's always a plan. I need to show you that there are a few elements that need to be pointed out here. Note some of the notable characteristics of the narrative. They are on the Sea of Tiberias, or rather the Sea of Galilee. They're on the Sea of Galilee fishing. When they can't catch a thing, Jesus shows up and they catch fish. That's the story. Sea of Galilee, trying to fish. Can't catch a thing. Mr. Jesus shows up, gives some instructions, and then ultimately they catch fish. I would tell you Bible readers would know that this story sounds very similar to what happens in Luke chapter 5. That they are on the same sea, doing the same thing with the same results. And Jesus shows up, and then they're able to catch fish. Now, this is a resurrection appearance in John, and it's placed at the end of the gospel. But in Luke's gospel, it happens at the beginning of the gospel. And it's the place that the disciples were called into ministry. It's interesting because this is the only resurrection appearance, y'all, that happens in Galilee. All of the other resurrection appearances happen in Judea, but this is the only one that occurs in Galilee. As a matter of fact, it forms a full circle moment to what the angel said to the women at the end of Mark when it says he is going ahead of you, not to Judea, but to Galilee. It's a full circle moment. All of us know something about full circle moments, don't we? That they communicate something to us that on Good Friday, like many of you, I was in here and I was listening and participating in our service, Sisters at the Cross. While we were in service, there was another sister that was crossing over into another genre. Beyonce released her famous, infamous album, Cowboy Carter. On that album, Beyonce has a song entitled Blackbird. The lyrics say, "Blackbird singing in the dead of night. That these broken wings, take these broken wings and learn how to fly. You were waiting for this moment to arise." I'd have you to know that those words are not original to Beyonce. As a matter of fact, they were originally penned by Paul McCartney, who wrote the song in 1968 for the Beatles. Now, at the time, he had looked at what was happening in the civil rights movement and then took notice of the Little Rock Nine and was inspired by that movement and then penned the lyrics to Blackbird. Blackbird, Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. That literally the Blackbird that he's referring to is black little girls. He didn't know that 56 years later, a black girl would be singing the song that he wrote for some other black girls and then produce it so that the whole world can see it again. It's a full circle moment. But I know something about full circle moments. You see, my brothers and sisters, I get the question even just this week. Ty, how in the world did you end up at Alfred Street? I'll give y'all the Cliff Notes version and I'll give it to you the rest of you a little bit later. You see, I was born in Memphis, Tennessee. Around 2017, I graduated from seminary, and then from there, I went and took my first staff position in Miami, Florida. I was there, from Waco to Miami, Florida. I'm talking about it was great. I mean, you couldn't imagine how life was moving to Miami, Florida. And then ultimately, I'm working down there as a youth and young adult pastor. While I'm there, things are going okay. I'm doing my thing, trying to do the best that I can. But then I remember some things started getting a little shaky, and I sensed some things weren't going that well. And then ultimately, I remember the day like it was yesterday. It was March 22nd of 2019. I went into the office with the expectation to talk about the furtherance of the ministry and the plans that I had, and I was met with some information that startled me and wrecked the rest of my life. I was told, Ty, we are going in a different direction. And I raised the question, what is it? Why is it that you're deciding to go in a different direction? I was given three reasons. You're ineffective, you got bad work ethic, and you don't fit here. I said, are you serious? He said, you're ineffective, you got bad work ethic, and you don't fit here. I mean, I got to tell y'all something. I struggled in a major way, because there I am in Miami, Florida. I'm not from there. I'm all the way 15 and some hours away from home. I'm there all by myself. That sometimes the only reason I was able to eat was because my best friend at a restaurant and would call me sometimes to feed me. My lights got cut off. My car got taken away. I was sitting there in Miami for months on months praying that some kind of way I would be able to make ends meet. I ultimately had to move back home, suffering from depression, began therapy, trying to leave myself of this heaviness, trying to get away from what I was struggling with, because I couldn't understand how is it that good black church people that would shout when I would preach would turn around and talk bad about me in meetings when I wasn't there. How was it that the same people whose children I went to go see and whose children I went and had counsel with would turn around and have these things to say about me? Time went on. I ended up having to be forced to move back to Memphis, Tennessee. I was there for a time trying to get my life together, but I have you to know, you asked me how I got to Alfred Street. I got to be honest, I had no interest of coming here because of my experiences. I did not trust working on another staff again. I said, no, I'm good. I don't need to be there. They'll figure something out. But then I remember I started having conversations. We started talking. We started talking about what the job would look like. And then I remember this day like it was yesterday. I was fired on March 22nd of 2019. But then it was March 22nd of 2022. I was in the gym with my brothers working out. I got a phone call from a number I didn't recognize. On the other end of that phone call was Howard John Wesley. Howard John Wesley said, hey, Ty, thank you for accepting my call. He began to talk about the job description and what we think potentially could happen if I came to Alfred Street. And what he didn't know was, he said, after looking at everything, he said, Ty, I think you would be a perfect fit. I said, hold on a second. He doesn't know, but I end up crying the rest of the call, because just 3 years later to the date, I was fired because I didn't fit. Only 3 years later to receive a call at the same time to be told that you fit. I'm trying to tell somebody that's a full circle moment. That full circle moments give revelation that ultimately tells you that you'll be able to keep on going. I'm trying to tell somebody here today that full circle moments, they demonstrate the sovereignty of God. They demonstrate the providence of the God that we serve. And I know it may be rough right now, but God will sometimes show you in a full circle moment. I've been working all the time. I had a plan all the time. For I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you and to give you hope and a future. I'm trying to tell you today, God's got a plan for your life. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, he's got a plan. He's got a plan. He's got a plan. I'm done. You'll be able to make it to your 1 o'clock brunch. I promise. I'm done. The revelation. There's a revelation that happens. John, the beloved disciple, gives a word. Hey, we're trying to fish. We ain't got none. Somebody shows up 100 yards away. Hey, do y'all have any fish? And he says, cast your nets on the right side. Cast them on the right side. And when you cast them on the right side, ultimately, you'll get some fish. It's interesting because they come out Because night fishing is more opportune. As a matter of fact, night fishing is more profitable on the Sea of Galilee, because if you fish at night, it gives you a head start on being able to produce fish for the market in the next morning. They came out at nighttime because they believed that they were doing their best. They were being profitable. They were being strategic and smart and coming out. And Jesus says, do you have any fish? But they caught nothing. Throw your nets on the side, on the right side, a simple instruction. But when they're obedient, they then are able to get some fish. Isn't it interesting that when you and I obey the strange request of God, some kind of way, things have a way of working out. Cast your nets on the right side. And John the Beloved then shouts out, that's the Lord. That's the Lord. And he says to Peter, it is the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, the text says he tied his outer clothing around him and jumped into the sea. I'm done, y'all. John tells him it's the Lord. He ties his outer clothing around him and then jumps into the sea. I have you to know that all throughout the Gospels, anytime you see Jesus, Peter, and water, there's always revelation. Anytime you see Jesus, Peter, and water, there's always some revelation to be gained. That Jesus often took those times to reveal himself not only to Peter, but also to the rest of the disciples. That here it is, he says, it is the Lord. I realize, he says, Peter says, it's the Lord. And while he isn't the first to recognize Jesus, he is the first to act on the revelation. Yeah. Yeah, I had to ask Pete. I said, Pete, wait a minute. Here it is, you on the boat. And John says, that's the Lord. You don't hesitate. You don't take a minute to pull some fish into the boat. You just jump into the lake. Pete, why would you do such a thing? Well, Todd, this ain't the first time I've been in this type of position. As a matter of fact, in Mark chapter 6, I was there on the Sea of Galilee, and we were caught up in a storm, and everything was going haywire. We thought we were about to lose our lives. And then ultimately what happens is that Jesus comes walking on the water in the fourth watch of the night and says, take courage, it is I, which in Greek says, I am. And I said, Rabbi, if that's you, do me a favor and let me come and walk out on the water to you. And then Jesus gives an invitation to me that I have never forgotten for the rest of my life. Jesus reaches out his hands and says, come to me. I got out on that water and I began to walk and I began to do something that nobody else had ever been able to do. He said, because what you have to understand, Ty, is that any time you know who Jesus is, it gives you the audacity to do things that others haven't been able to do. I'm trying to tell somebody, I'm coming to your house today. If you know who Jesus is, it ought to give you the audacity, the unmitigated gall to walk on water while others are still in the boat. It ought to give you the audacity to go and launch the business. It ought to give you the audacity to launch the YouTube page. It ought to give you the audacity to file for the grant. It ought to give you the audacity to go back to school. It ought to give you the audacity to fill out the application. When you know who Jesus is, it gives you the audacity to do things that others can't do. I'm coming
around,
but I'm done. But here it is, Peter. He may not be the first to know, but he is the first to ask. This isn't the end for Peter. It's in the end for Peter. As a matter of fact, because of this revelation, it's the Lord. That's going to be in the book of Acts. Peter's going to preach a sermon, and the content of his message is that Jesus is Lord. And 3,000 people are going to come to know the Lord. I'm saying, when you know who Jesus is, it gives you courage and audacity to do things that you wouldn't otherwise be able to do. I'm done. But that's essentially what happens. Every time you and I come into church, every time you and I are in the good sanctuary, that we have the audacity to say God is good, even when things feel bad. We have the audacity to say God's gonna make a way, even when we can't even see the way. We have the audacity to say God is a provider when our income doesn't seem to be making sense. We have the audacity to believe that ultimately God is going to bring a child back home. We have the audacity to believe that ultimately God is a healer. We have the audacity to believe that this earthly temple, although it will dissolve, we've got another building not made. We've got the audacity. I tell you, because when you know who Jesus is, he comes with audacity. The other day, other day, that's the seventh time. I'm a black preacher. That's what we do. Get used to it. Y'all be all right. I'm done. Paul, 3 days ago. 3 days ago, I was on Instagram Live. I'm on Instagram Live because I was talking about our 75 hard challenge that we're doing. And I was on there and I was talking and giving and telling people that, hey, man, y'all gotta be a part of this. It's going to be dope. It's going to be a good time. Make sure you hop, make sure that you sign up for the 75 hard challenge. While I'm on there, I'm telling them that ultimately, that I'm at a new gym today, that I've never been to this gym before, that I typically go to one gym, but I made the decision that I was going to go to another gym because I just wanted something different on that particular day. While I'm on the gym, while I'm on Instagram Live, I tell them, I say, hey, I'm at Lifetime Fitness right now. Now, pause here for a moment. If any of you all know anything about gym memberships, you know that there is lifetime prices and then there are other gym prices. So much so that one of my friends on Instagram Live, her name is Kaya. She comes to Kaya sometimes. She says, "Oh, you at Instagram? You at Lifetime Fitness? That means that you got money. That means that you able to afford a lifetime membership." I said, "Hold on, sweetheart. Hold on 1 second. I need to tell you something. Ty does not have any money." I said, "But Robert Jones does have money." She said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Well, Ty can't afford a lifetime membership, but Robert C. Jones in Memphis, Tennessee can afford a lifetime membership." I said, "Listen, the only reason I'm able to be in Lifetime is because when I walk up to the counter, because my father and I share the same name, I scan my card and his account pops up. And so whenever they are looking and allow me in, my dad account pops up, and that gives me access to their sauna, that gives me access to their jacuzzi, it gives me access to their treadmills, their stairmasters, and everything else, and their tiles. I get to be in there just like everybody else because my account is linked to my father." Goodbye, Alfred Street. May God bless y'all real good. But that's all I came today to tell somebody. You ain't got to worry about a thing, because as long as Jesus makes things work in your life, everything is gonna be all right. Would you do me a favor and grab your neighbor by the head? I feel like having church markers. Give me everything. Say, "Neighbor, I got a word for you to help you get through the rest of the week. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy is gonna come in the morning." Bye-bye now, y'all. I gotta let y'all go, but I only want you to know that you got a tomorrow, that God's got a plan, and this ain't the end of your story, that because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, because Jesus lives, I'm done now, y'all. Thank y'all.
y'all for letting me share. I promised I wouldn't be too long, but can y'all help me one more time? Turn. I said turn. Turn. I said turn. Y'all ain't turning. I said turn. Turn to your neighbor and grab that neighbor by the hand. Rock that neighbor and shake that neighbor. Rock. Rock that neighbor. Shake. Shake that neighbor. And say, neighbor, the reason why I look the way I look, the reason why I have what I have, is because it's not my account. It's the Lord. Lord have mercy. Grab somebody one time. If God's been good to you, lift your hands in the air. Shout yes, Lord. Shout yes. Lord, I think I almost feel good. Do y'all know why we're shouting? Do you know why we're praising? I know it's the Sunday after Easter, but I might as well tell the story. It was one Friday. They put him on the cross. They put a spear in his side. He said, if you think I'll fight you, nail my hands. If you think I'll run, nail my feet. They hung him high, stretched him wide. He dropped his head. And then he died. If my daddy was here, he say he died until the sun refused to shine. He died until the moon dripped away in blood. He died until the S-O-N went out. S-U-N went out. And the S-O-N came out. He died until the earth reeled and rocked like a drunken man. But you and I know that that ain't the end. That ain't the end of the story. Because early, I said early Sunday morning, I need you to put your Baptist voice on. Shout early Sunday morning. He got up with all power in his hand. And if he got up, you can get up. If he got up, you can get up. Do me one favor.
There's somebody here today. There's somebody here today. You wondering why your neighbor doing all that shouting and all that yelling and all that stuff. It's because we know that Jesus got up. And got up. And here's the thing. If your problem isn't bigger than a dead Jesus, that means that he can handle it. So listen, we don't want to skip this moment. The deacons are going to come now. Listen, the heart of Alfred Street is open at this time. There's somebody here. You're looking to be in relationship with Jesus Christ. And we want you to come now. Don't hesitate. Don't listen. We with you. This is your family. We want you to come. We want you to come wherever you are. I don't care where you are. Come wherever you are. Because you don't know me, I don't know you. And you saying, how he know all my business? Come on. Y'all can do better than that. Come on. Yeah. 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 Come on. Come on, somebody else. Oh my.
Oh my brother.
Come on, somebody else. Oh, for Christ.
Oh my sister. Oh my sister.
I'm trying to tell you,
He will give you brand new life.
Not just any life, but
life abundantly.
Come on, do yourself a favor. Right now. Living testimony. He will
give you brand new life.
Do yourself a favor, eh? Come to Christ. Alfred Street, will you do me a favor and give God praise for the two that have decided to come. Come on, y'all can do better than that. Whoa.
To God be the glory for the great things he has done. Amen. Will you put your hands together one more time and just bless God? Hallelujah. Royal priesthood will sing and we will give our benediction as we go out into the world to declare to them that because he lives, there's nothing that we cannot handle or face. God bless you, Alfred Street.
All the glory.
now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, he who can present us faultless with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, all glory, dominion, and power, now, hence, and forevermore. The grace and peace of God. God bless you.
Greetings. As we shower in the month of April, welcome to Alfred Street Worship Experience. We welcome you every Sunday at 8 a.m. and 11 a.m. in person and live stream online via our website and social media platforms. Now, here are the upcoming announcements. We know that these are difficult and challenging times. We invite you to stay connected by participating in our online worship services and remain faithful in your giving online via our Alfred Street website, ASBC app, and on our text messaging system.
Everyone, please be sure to scan the QR code with your phone, which will take you directly to our giving page on our website.
If you have any questions about giving, please feel free to email our finance department at finance@alfredstreet.org. If you're interested in becoming a member of the historic Alfred Street Baptist Church, please email deacons with an S at alfredstreet.org or complete the membership form on our website or on our ASBC app.
Our daily prayer call was a huge success during Seek 2024, thanks in part to all of you. As a result, we'll resume our daily prayer call starting on Monday at 7 a.m. Eastern Time. However, we will continue to utilize the Zoom platform that we've used during Seek 2024. Please visit our website, social media platforms, and or eBlast for additional information.
Calling all members, family, and friends, it's time to get back to Sunday school, beginning in the month of April. Join our Sunday school community in the theme, What's Your Image of the Church? Exploring the early church as we continue to find meaning in the church today, every Sunday at 9:30 a.m. There are classes for every member of the family. We are here for you in person or online virtually for deep roots bearing fruits. Email sundayschool@alfredstreet.org.
Alfred Street, let's take a journey to the cross. Join the evangelism ministry for an encounter on Saturday, April 13th, a virtual online experience from 9:30 a.m. until 11 a.m. This evangelism encounter is a learning event designed for individuals to learn more about everyday evangelism and how important it is to the family of God's growth and effectiveness. This 90-minute session is open to all who want to explore and sharpen their witnessing skills. No prior knowledge is required to join this event. Register your attendance online today. Email evangelism@alfredstreet.org with any questions. Mention all high school seniors of Alfred Street Baptist Church. It's that time of year. The 2024 ASBC High School Senior Scholarship applications are now being accepted online. Calling all parents and guardians of high school seniors to visit our website. Complete the application today. More detailed information can be found on our website, so don't wait. Please complete your application today. Speaking of grief, Alfred Street's Office of Christian Care and Counseling, in conjunction with our Grief Share Ministry, presents their 2024 Spring Sessions, starting on March 14th through June 13th, and every Thursday night, starting at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. This will be a virtual online experience. You must register online to receive the webinar information. Remember, grief is a natural, complex, and emotional response to loss. The Grief Share sessions are a great support system. Email griefshare@alfredstreet.org for details.
Hey everybody, I'm Minister Otis Byrd Jr. and it's my honor to serve as the assistant to the pastor for online ministry and engagement here at the Alfred Street Baptist Church. And guess what? I have some exciting news to share with you. I'm glad you asked. It's our new live pre-worship broadcast, The Prelude. I got you. Every Sunday morning, we will go live reporting from inside the walls of ASBC to inform you of what's going on in these Alfred streets, to intentionally engage with our faithful online viewers, and just to have some fun together before worship service begins. It will begin airing on Sunday, February 4th. Online viewers, get ready to interact with us live in the chat. Get ready to share with us your name, your city, and any other comments you'd like to share with us. We are excited about this endeavor, and we hope to see you there.
Are you looking for an incredible opportunity to share your musical talents? If so, look no further. Alfred Street Sanctified Symphony Orchestra is thrilled to announce that they are recruiting talented musicians like you to join their harmonious family. They're calling for all musicians to join them every Friday evening from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Send an email to sanctifiedsymphony@alfredstreet.org if interested. They can't wait to welcome you into the Alfred Street Baptist Church Sanctified Symphony Orchestra.
Hey, Alfred Street. Verses is back in stock. Our Verses team has been working around the clock to create another batch of our popular Verses Bible-based trivia card game, and they're now available for purchase. That's right, purchase your set of Verses cards today before we sell out again. Visit our website or ASBC app and be the first to get your hands on Verses, a Bible-based trivia game by Alfred Street Baptist Church.
Alfred Street's Office of Christian Care and Counseling, in conjunction with the Health and Well-Being Recovery Ministry, present a bi-weekly peer support session virtually via Zoom. That's every first and third Wednesday from 7 to 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Visit our website for the Zoom link information. The Recovery Ministry peer support sessions will provide a safe and confidential environment to confront addictions, compulsive behaviors, and issues that interfere with a renewed relationship with God. Email recovery@alfredstreet.org for details. Calling all parents and guardians of children, youth, and teens. Alfred Street's Children and Youth Ministries are back. We're currently accepting registrations for Kid Street, Crossover, and Higher Ground. Visit our website to register your child or youth today. Alfred Street invites everyone to join the Joyce K. Peterson Handbell Ringers. They are thrilled to announce that their ensemble recruitment is now open. If you have a passion for music and a heart for worship, we invite you to be a part of this harmonious journey. If you can read music and are eager to contribute your talents to a musical ministry that touches souls, this is your moment to shine. For more info and to express your interest, please email handbell@alfredstreet.org.
Our Faye Savage Gunn Tutorial Ministry has a new home online. Communicate, learn, and stay informed all in one place. Visit our new webpage and check us out today at alfredstreet.org. Email tutorial@alfredstreet.org for details.
Our ASBC Village Study Guide is now available on the website to download. Be sure to check out a copy if you want to go deeper with Pastor Wesley's sermon prepared for you by the Villages of Alfred Street team. The guide is available online at alfredstreet.org. Hey, Alfred Street family and friends. Are you visiting us for the very first time? Or perhaps you're new to Alfred Street and you want to stay connected to us or receive the latest Alfred Street updates via text? If so, all visitors, text the word visitors with an S to our new direct text number, 571-977-4525. That's 571-977-4525.
Also, we invite you to tune in to our Faith Forward weekly radio broadcast featuring Pastor Howard John Wesley every Sunday morning at 7:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on Magic 102.3 FM and 92.7 FM for a powerful sermon that will move you forward in your faith.
We want to thank you for tuning into Alpha Street's live worship experience. Again, this is Charnell King, Social Media Manager. For more information on what's happening here at Alpha Street, make sure to check out our website and social media platforms. We hope you have a blessed week.